A few months ago, it looked like Republicans had everything they needed to take down President Obama. But as it turns out, their obsession over White House scandals proved to be nothing more than a complete waste of time. Joining me now to discuss the Republicans' obsession over these fake scandals is author Cliff Schecter. Cliff, thank you very much for joining me today.
Thanks for having me, man.
So, okay, you know, first it was Benghazi, then it was the IRS, then it was the Justice Department spying on reporters. Take us back through all of these scandals that the Republicans were absolutely certain were going to help them impeach President Obama.
I know, it's amazing. You can actually go back further if you want to be really romantic and take a trip back through the Republican Congress. Remember Solyndra?
Oh, goodness.
wasn't that a beautiful one? We had the Benghazi scandal, which the Joint Chiefs of Staff made very clear was based on, you know, there was a judgment made by the military that were in Tripoli, which is 600 miles away. They could not get there in time to help, and they chose not to. So it wasn't the Obama administration didn't send people as they should have. Then suddenly it was who changed talking points, but it turns out the CIA had nothing to do with the Obama White House. And the real scandal is that some Republican took the emails and changed around what was sent them to try to make Obama look guilty. That is what should be investigated, actually.
Well, see, and you know, I think it's great that you point out too that, you know, most Republicans cannot even, you know, point to Benghazi on a map. But I think what helped the Benghazi story sell on places like Fox News was that it is very difficult to understand. And when something is so difficult for people to comprehend, for them to wrap their heads around it, it can be reduced to the least basic of principles. So they're able to say, okay, well, there was an attack. Obama did nothing. He should be impeached. You know, ignore all of the intricate details that most people can't even understand anyway, especially this, you know, Fox News audience. And that's what happens. They believe that Obama did something wrong here. But they overlook the fact that when George W. Bush was president, we had 13 different attacks on U.S. embassies all over the world. 98 people dead, you know, dozens more injured. And there wasn't a word. There was not a word about that in any of this conservative media.
No, back then, Daryl Issa was probably still playing to boost his next car. it's amazing. And again, this is a playbook they've run. Remember, they couldn't defeat Bill Clinton, so they impeached him for sex. When they can't defeat Democrats, they couldn't defeat Elliot Spitzer, so there's some shady dealings about whether they use the Patriot Act to expose what he was doing. I mean, this is just what Republicans do when they can't win, because they believe they always deserve power. And when the public rejects them, as it does these days quite often, they'll find whatever they can. Now, there was no scandal in Benghazi, as you pointed out. I have friends in the Foreign Service who've been in, you know, in diplomatic areas that have been attacked. When you're in certain places in Africa and Asia and other places, it's dangerous. You know, yeah. This when you sign up for the job. It was a terrible tragedy what happened, but it was not unprecedented. You remember there was that storming of the embassy in Iran. In 79. I mean, these, you know, it's terrible, and I don't want to say that it wasn't a tragedy, but it happens. And they took something, essentially the deaths of Americans, and they tried to turn that into a political plus, which just shows how craven they are. But this is what they do. It's a Karl Rove playbook. If you go all the way back to how he used to win races in Texas, he found a couple of friendly FBI guys that would show up at somebody's office on the flimsiest of circumstances. They'd get their article on the front page of the newspaper the next day, and that's all they need. Then they had their campaign commercial. It's what they do.
Right. And they're not going to take, you know, the Fox News audience is not going to take the time to look into what happened, to look at this. All they hear is, you know, a guy like Steve Doocy telling them that, okay, the president lied to them, even though the president did not lie to them. It was the Republicans who altered those emails.
The Fox News audience is barely past fractions.
Well, and, you know, that brings us to the other topic, too. I think the IRS, you know, scandal was one of the best ones that the Republicans had, because it was so overblown. It was so just, you know, not even sensical the way they were discussing this. You know, and now recently we find out that, oh, it was actually a conservative Tea Partier at the IRS who said, you know what, we need to take a closer look at these guys. Has anybody bothered to mention that to the guys over at Fox News or to the Koch brothers, you know, sponsored Tea Party rally?
I don't think anybody has mentioned it. They've got that sort of bubble they sit in. So if it's been mentioned to them, it's just easily ignored, like all other facts and weird things like science and medicine. You know, they wanted that to be a scandal. That was just perfect for them, right? The IRS, they're coming to take your taxes, and they're doing it to you because you're conservative. You have to pay taxes to big government, and you're a conservative, so they're targeting you. I mean, it just fit it checked really most of the paranoia boxes perfectly for them. And it turned out you're right. First of all, the guy who was running things there was a right winger. Second of all, turns out, guess what? They were searching for groups that had the word progressive in it too. In other words, like that, because the truth is with under our current law, thank you, right-wing Supreme Court, a lot of C4s are pretty shady overall, whether they're on the left or the right, whether they're supposed to educate, but let's be honest, they're often advocating, involved in political activity beyond where they're supposed to be. And so these guys were doing their job and they were looking into it. But of course, Daryl Issa knew what was going on. He knew what he'd heard in private testimony, and he sort of selectively leaked all the items that would make people think it was a conspiracy to go after the right. Thankfully, Elijah Cummings started releasing the entire transcripts to show that was just a bunch of bunk. But again, Daryl Issa is literally just a two-bit con man who found his way into millions after, you know, stealing cars and potentially burning down his own factory, which is still one of these things that's suspicious 30 years later. You know, there's plenty of stuff to investigate, as there always is with conservatives. It's just that's not what gets investigated. I mean, you know, the fact that the Interior Department under George W. Bush was busy trading favors for prostitution, for prostitutes, and, you know, for being bribed, and that was probably only the 25th highest scandal after Katrina and lying our way into Iraq, and what was ignored before 9/11, and you can go on and on and on, you know, exposing Valerie Plame's identity, you know, the politicizing of the U.S. attorneys. Right. I mean, this, you know, nothing Obama has done would make the top 100 Bush scandals, but don't tell the Republican Congress who never bothered to look into any of those.
Right. And so, okay, all of these scandals went absolutely nowhere. It was a complete waste of our time. You know, even
and
when
money
they called
from a group of people.
Well, and money, even when, you know, they called Eric Holder in to come, you know, testify about the Justice Department spying on reporters. That was a waste of time. It was a waste of our resources. It produced nothing. Meanwhile, you know, since they know they can't win anything on these scandals, what we're seeing start popping up all over this country is now they're bringing back the culture war. Now they're going back after this war on women that worked out so well for them in last year's election. But they've brought it up again. These people don't learn. And when they are frightened, when they're backed into a corner, they will always go back to these culture war issues.
That's right. Well, you brought it up well. They're like, you know, when you have a trapped animal. I mean, that's what they are, because they don't have a part of the brain that does logic. They just do fear and paranoia and anger and the rest. So you're right. They go back to the issues that motivate their base. Oh, my God, women have control over their bodies. Let's take that away. Oh, my God, two men actually love each other. Let's go after that. You know, they go to those sort of base issues because they've got nothing. In the end, and the truth of the matter is that with the exception of about 15 states in this country, every other state is becoming more demographically a state where Republicans can't do this stuff and win. So what do you do then? Well, you pass Citizens United, you let the Koch brothers and local Koch brothers in different states try to buy elections. You go after the Voting Rights Act so that they can try to disqualify parts of this growing Asian, Latino, African-American, college-educated, white, and female, growing coalition on the Democratic side. You know, you do everything in your power to try to sort of win by cheating, because you what their policies are appeal to maybe 20%, 30% in most of the electorate.
Right. And it's important to remember, too, that even in the South, the demographics down here are shifting to become more progressive. And so that's why we're seeing, you know, people like Rick Scott institute all of this gerrymandering to make it to where Republicans can win in districts where statistically they shouldn't be able to. You know, helped in part by the Supreme Court striking down, you know, parts of the Voting Rights Act. You know, that's going to be terrible in the upcoming midterm elections next year. And then we also have corporations who can pour money into races all over the place. I know a great example is the fact that Michelle Bachmann, of all people up in Minnesota, raised millions of dollars from companies down in South Florida. You know, before Citizens United, that wouldn't have been allowed. But more importantly, people need to look and ask themselves, why does a company in South Florida have any stock at all in somebody like Michelle Bachmann?
Right. And then you watch, you know, in her case, she won't be running again because she's all sorts of corrupt and looks like a legislator in Iowa to support her campaign. But if she were running again, you'd want to look, or maybe even in the meantime, at her voting record. And magically, you find her voting in favor of things for said South Florida company that she should otherwise have no interest in and nothing to do with. I mean, it's such corruption, it's sort of sickening. The fact that the Supreme Court could say that this could occur and it wouldn't be the appearance of corruption shows that they're bald-faced liars. You can't really trust them on anything. I mean, John Roberts, for that matter, who tries to smooth it all over. These guys are politicians and rogues. They're not really judges. Just keep in mind that at one point in time, both Louis Gohmert and Jeff Sessions were judges. They were actually charged with judging stuff. So, I mean, that's what you've got. And you bring up Florida. Look, Florida, it started happening 10, 15 years ago. At this point, Virginia is a swing state. North Carolina, Obama won once and is a swing state. Georgia's demographics are such that they nominate one of these lunatics like Paul Brown, or one of these other people that thinks evolution comes from the pit of hell. Obama only lost Georgia by 7 points. It's quickly becoming a swing state, too. Eventually, South Carolina in 15 years will get there, and Texas is on its way. So demographically, what they believe in is going to be something that's hugely popular in Wyoming and Oklahoma and Alabama. But in most of the country, where the demographics are changing in enormous ways, to quote their Christianist friends, they're going to be left behind. And that's why they have to do these things like what you're talking about with voting rights and with pouring big money into elections. Because if you don't have the playing field tilted hugely in their direction, they'll get wiped out.
Right. Cliff Schecter, author of the best-selling book, The Real McCain, president of Libertas LLC. Thank you so much for joining me today.
Thanks for having me on, Farron. I appreciate it.